increasing armament may be checked. The apparent failure of the meetings in London last spring was most disappointing. My government are most anxious that effective pressure be maintained upon disarmament commission to be unrelenting in its efforts to lessen the frightful burden of armament and military preparations. I therefore most cordially welcome the substantial contribution to the general debate yesterday of the Soviet delegation, as well as the proposal of the American Secretary of State for the international development of peaceful uses of atomic energy and the addition of the resulting agenda item to that effect. Ethiopia hopes that effective step forward in this field may lead to a relaxation of tension in the military field. But quite as important is the hope that international consideration of the possible use of this vast new resource of power and energy in close relation to the development of power and energy requirements of the industrial developed regions of the world may provide a stimulus to creative thinking and scientific research and could truly usher a new era of international collaboration and international economic development. The delegation will accordingly press for the establishment of effective and substantial international economic instrument and agencies for the expansion of not only technical assistance, but for the financing and promoting of the basic development of the underdeveloped areas of the world. My delegation remains convinced that there is closest connection between the effectiveness of collective security under the Charter and the climate of economic development throughout the world. The same boldness and willing assumption of great risk that crowned the organization's successful application of the principle of collective security must characterize its approach to the interrelated problem of technical assistance and economic development. Of the Charter. I am confident, Mr. President, that in this year of great calm but higher tension in the affairs of the world, we shall make the best possible use of the calm afforded to us and shall at the same time be urged to our task by the tension that surrounds us. Thank you.
Conformément à cette politique qui consiste à promouvoir partout dans le monde l'indépendance, le droit des peuples à disposer d'eux-mêmes, il importe à l'avenir que notre organisation s'évertue davantage à prêter de l'assistance aux pays sous-développés. On n'ignore pas que beaucoup de pays représentés ici ont besoin de cette assistance et qu'il y a quelques jours seulement, le représentant d'un des pays qui est compté parmi les plus avancés au point de vue social a déclaré du haut de ses tribunes que son pays était, à certains points de vue, un pays sous-développé. On se souvient également de l'appel éloquent et angoissant du distingué délégué de l'Équateur pour le développement de ce programme, appel qui trouve un écho dans le cœur de bien d'autres délégués ici présents. Un autre domaine où il importe de renforcer la collaboration entre les États par rapport à ce que nous avons pu réaliser jusqu'ici est aussi celui des mesures de coercition. Si nous, les petits et moyens États, sommes en droit de demander à l'organisation de l'assistance technique, il n'est que juste que nous nous montrions prêts à accepter toutes les responsabilités que la Charte et l'organisation nous imposent. Ses voeux les plus sincères pour que la période de détente qui s'ouvre devant nous marque encore plus de progrès non seulement dans ce domaine, mais aussi, comme l'énonce le beau langage de la Charte, pour le maintien de la justice et du respect des obligations nées des traités et autres sources du droit international.
Aux attaques, aux accusations plutôt, qui viennent d'être prononcées par le chef de la délégation suivante. C'est avec beaucoup de regret que nous sommes obligés de prendre la parole pour mettre certaines mises au point. Mais le chef de la délégation de la Somalie ne nous a pas laissé d'autres alternatives. Je serai très bref. Je vais simplement au fait. Monsieur le Président, il y a 10 ans, exactement, dans cette même salle, au moment de la signature de la Charte, l'Éthiopie a été l'objet d'accusations, de fausses accusations, par le chef de la délégation de la Somalie. À cette date, c'était moi-même, tout en m'excusant, que j'étais obligé encore de répondre. Il y a 10 ans, à l'histoire se répète, nous avons été aussi accusés. De quoi? Premièrement, que nous avons mobilisé nos troupes, que nous avons massé de troupes à la frontière de la Somalie. C'est absolument faux. Ce n'est pas vrai, et je regrette de le dire, ce n'est même pas vraisemblable.
We started having coup d'état here, coup d'état there, a lieutenant taking over power here. And then you say to yourself, what's going on? A lieutenant, or a major, or a colonel for that matter, replacing Tafewa Balewa? A colonel replacing Modiba Keita? Or some general replacing Nkuma? Until the end, we had a major replacing Haile Selassie. So where did the vision go? And so here we are, as if we have lost our compass, as if we have lost our objective, as if we have nothing to live for. And that's what really bothers a person like me, who was there at the beginning and who is still alive to witness to what depths of incertitude Africa has come to. What happened?
Mr. Chairman, I am not here to respond to his proposal that this organization be moved to another headquarters, to another city. That's up to us, up to the Assembly of Heads of State and Government, who, through a unanimous decision, have made the decision to locate this organization in Addis Ababa. There are some things which the government of Libya must understand. Africa is not for sale. We are independent from foreign states. Africans are jealous of their independence and sovereignty. No matter how wealthy Libya is, that means nothing for us. And you cannot buy. There is no head of state. There is no representative of an African government in this room that's prepared to accept dictation from Libya. You better learn that. The philosophy of Libya is cultural and linguistic chauvinism. It is religious fanaticism. It's arrogance above all. Arrogance.
The state has every right to have any bilateral relation with any country, with Cuba, with Soviet Union, or with any other country. The whole purpose is to stand against aggression. The Ethiopian First Forces are fighting against Somali aggressive forces inside Ethiopian territory. And in those days,
when the Somalis carried out aggression against Ethiopia, they used to say 97% of Ethiopia has been captured, the war for Somalia is over. That was why the Somalis were saying, Ofugadem, 97%. Now when the struggle went, vice versa, the Somalis, they are now trying to brainwash world public opinion, in which they say that Ethiopia is trying to carry out aggression against Somalia, while we still fight inside Ethiopian territory. The same situation is up in Eritrea. This is the same situation. We are struggling. In the Eritrean case, as I have said, we are trying to solve that problem peacefully.
Right now, at this moment, Somali armed forces are fighting with our regular and militia forces deep inside our territory. And to this, if there is no peaceful solution, could be found to this, the only alternative is to repel the Somali aggressors from our territory. And the Ethiopian government needs assistance from peace-loving and friendly countries all over the world. The assistance which it is getting right now from friendly countries like the Soviet Union is adequate enough to repel the aggression. I have said before in front of the press, and I say it here, that Ethiopia has no intention of exporting or going over beyond the boundary, beyond the existing boundary. We would like, and we want you to believe and to be convinced that the Ethiopian war will be limited within the Ethiopian territory.
As you all know, the United States had been supplying arms to Ethiopia during the regime of Haile Selassie and even afterwards. But for reasons which are not clear to us, after the revolution broke out in Ethiopia, which had the intention of liberating the Ethiopian people from oppression and the building of a society from exploitation, a society of justice and equality, we don't understand why the United States was inimical to this revolution. And knowing fully well that the Somali regime had an aggressive intent against Ethiopia, which it cherished for a very long time, the United States embargoed on the arms supplies to Ethiopia, the arms for which we paid with money that came from the sweat of the toiling masses of Ethiopia. And faced with this aggression and lack of arms, we had to turn to some others who are willing to sell us arms. And we believe that this is our sovereign right, and we are buying arms from all those who are willing to sell arms to us. But this does not mean that Ethiopia is dictated by any power, by any superpower, or by anyone.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I thank you, and I'm delighted to be invited to present my testimony on Ethiopia, a country I was forced to leave some 4 or 5 years ago in opposition to Mengistu Haile Mariam's Stalinist and repressive policies. Unfortunately, however, that country has once again come under the clutches of another ruthless and Stalinist tyrant. So it is almost melodramatic. Out goes Mengistu to Harare, and in comes Meles Zenawi through London, a Tweedledee replacing a Tweedledum. The outcome of the London conference was most disastrous for Ethiopia, most destabilizing for the Horn of Africa, and most disquieting for the rest of Africa. Trouble is, the conference, if it really was a conference, suffered from one fatal structural deficiency, which in turn led to some fatal outcomes. First, the confab brought together ethnically stabilizing for the Horn of Africa and most disquieting for the rest of Africa. Trouble is, the conference, if it really was a conference, suffered from one fatal structural deficiency, which in turn led to some fatal outcomes. First, the confab brought together ethnically based armed groups who are the sworn enemies of the Ethiopian nation state and have formed an alliance to dismember and tear down that very state. Those groups with a multi-ethnic base who enjoy the broad support of the Ethiopian people, the vast majority of people who do not belong to any of these political groupings, either armed or political, were pointedly and deliberately excluded. Imagine, sir, imagine, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, the PLO's Yasser Arafat sitting together with the Popular Front's George Habash to decide on the fate of the State of Israel without Israel's participation. Second, the conference also sent a signal and set the stage for Ethiopia's dismemberment through Eritrean secession. It was a blow, a dagger blow, aimed at the very heart of the integrity of the Ethiopian state system and a serious threat to the integrity of the African political order. It's no wonder that the decision outraged millions of Ethiopians all over. One cannot overstress the deep-seated, instinctive, and fierce resolve of all Ethiopians to preserve their national unity and independence. That unique independence had been defended by fierce resistance to no less than 8 foreign invasions, and that had forged a consciousness and pride of national unity and culture found nowhere on the continent of Africa. Those foreign invasions have by no means spared the territory known only in modern times as Eritrea. In fact, of the 8 invasions from the south, the west, and the south, and the north have involved Eritrea. This was scarcely surprising. For centuries, it was the political and the cultural center of Ethiopia, with the capital at Adulis, symbol of the independence which others, even before the colonial period, sought to suppress. Ethiopia, as the cultural, political, and economic sector of the Horn and its coastline of Eritrea, stood as a vast barrier to both European and Arab expansionist designs. That the people of Eritrea had
through a process of self-determination under the auspices of the United Nations had exercised the right to determine and had determined that by deliberately and voluntarily linking their territory in federal association with Ethiopia was unfortunately conveniently forgotten. Any future decision on Eritrea, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I would assure you, if and when it is taken, would have to be taken not by the inhabitants of one province, but by the people of Ethiopia as a whole. Thirdly, the decision to let in the TPLF, the African counterpart of the Asian Khmer Rouge, I would like to call them the Khmer Noir.
Yes.
The decision to let in the TPLF and occupy Addis Ababa and grab state power was tragic and inexplicable. How an ideologically intoxicated, ethnically narrowly based guerrilla force, as Francis Lemond did say in this morning's editorial, headed by a radical Stalinist with no experience to raise and administer a family, let alone administer a country of 50 million people, should be asked to march in and assume state responsibility is beyond me to comprehend, and I ask for divine intervention. That must be the first time when a self-declared Stalinist is sanctioned by the United States to take over state power. The upshot of all these decisions and actions is to seriously compromise Ethiopia's fundamental interests. And the country is saddled now with a Stalinist regime which is just as repressive as Mengistu Haile Mariam's. But whatever has happened, Mr. Chairman, has happened in London. And it is time to correct mistakes and move on. There is no suggestion on my part at any rate that there was any deliberate plan on behalf of Mr. Cohen or the State Department or the administration in general to put Ethiopia in jeopardy. That has never been suggested. Ethiopia is always in love with Americans and respectful of the traditions and values and democratic institutions of America. So it remains to this very day. But mistakes have been made, and it is important, I think, to correct the mistakes and move on. And how can we move on? Well, I think the first thing is that the United States should reaffirm its traditional support for Ethiopia's unity and territorial integrity. The conflict in Eritrea should be resolved within the framework of a united Ethiopia on the basis of some force of federal association. Next, the United States should also work for the speedy democratization of the Ethiopian political system and the institution of multi-party democracy in the country. The U.S. should have as its immediate objective the broadening of the current narrowly based rebel junta so that the vast majority of people excluded from the system under the London arrangements could be embraced and brought into the system. It should also work for the withdrawal of the EPLF and EPRDF occupying forces from Addis Ababa and other towns, and their replacement by a national army and a police representing all ethnic groups in the country. To that end, Mr. Chairman, I urge Assistant Secretary of State Mr. Cohen to invite and preside over a conference of all political groups, both within and outside the country. I particularly urge him to invite the coalition of Ethiopian Democratic Forces, which enjoys wide support in Ethiopia. The Ethiopian people love and respect and admire the American people. The United States is the only country with the political moral stature to usher in democracy in Ethiopia and help defend it against dismemberment. I therefore ask members of the committee, I also ask the administration, in particular the State Department, to reconsider the decisions taken and the actions taken in London and bring about an orderly transfer of power from this tiny, tightly-knit group of a military junta to a broadly based representative government in Addis Ababa with the unity and territorial integrity of the country intact. I thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. President, I would like to join previous speakers in expressing my pleasure in seeing you preside over this session, which marks another important turning point in the Council's consideration of the situation between Iraq and Kuwait. I also wish to seize this opportunity to assure you of my delegation's full cooperation in the discharge of your heavy responsibilities at this important meeting of the Council. Mr. President, in another era, at another place, nations of the world met to deliberate upon a blatant aggression perpetrated by an expansionist state against a weak and defenseless people. The time was 55 years ago, and that defenseless people was none other than my own, the Ethiopian people, which had to appeal to the League of Nations to apply its own principles and take a stand against the aggression. Historical records clearly show the serious failure of the League of Nations to act in defense of its own covenant, thus letting brute force to triumph, however briefly, over morality and legality. With the benefit of hindsight, it is often asserted, perhaps rightly too, that had the League of Nations acted more forcefully and in unison at that critical time in defense of the international legality, the course of history would have been different, and very probably the world could have been spared the destructions and terrible tragedy of the Second World War. So, when Iraq launched its naked and unprovoked aggression against small Kuwait, we in Ethiopia saw clearly the danger of history repeating itself and were able to relate easily the plight of the Kuwaiti people to that faced by us in 1935. That the Ethiopian government acted promptly in condemning that blatant aggression and in supporting collective action in this council, therefore, was in no small measure a reflection of our own historical experience. It was also meant to signal that in the 1990s, the international community must not repeat the mistakes of the 1930s. Mr. President, almost 4 months have elapsed since the invasion of Kuwait. During these 4 months, numerous diplomatic efforts have been undertaken to resolve the crisis peacefully. However, the peaceful measures taken so far, including economic sanctions, have not produced the desired results since the occupation of Kuwait still continues. Indeed, the various resolutions adopted so far do not appear to have convinced Iraq of the seriousness and determination of the international community, which has waited patiently to see the return of the Gulf situation to the status quo ante. Although the patience of the world community is running out and hopes for a peaceful resolution of the crisis are diminishing, the Council, in reaffirmation of its objective to settle the problem peacefully, is once again meeting today to resolve and provide Iraq one more chance to mend its way and respect the will of the international community. Many have argued, with good intentions I must say, that the international community must wait still longer before considering additional measures. But we have learned from experience that economic sanctions could have effect only with the passage of time, and even that could be achieved only with complete and universal compliance. More importantly, the people of Kuwait rightfully demand the immediate restoration of their sovereignty. We must not, therefore, wait much longer, for justice delayed, as is often said, could very well be justice denied. We owe it not only to the Kuwaiti people, but also to ourselves to live up to our commitment to help end the occupation of Kuwait by Iraq and thereby fulfill our obligations to the preservation of international peace and security. Mr. President, Ethiopia, as you all know, is located not far from the Arabian Peninsula and the Persian Gulf, and as a result is seriously concerned both about the current crisis as well as its long-term impact. We believe that it would not be too early to start thinking about a post-Iraqi withdrawal scenario leading to the establishment of durable stability, peace and security in the region, to obviate the possibility of hegemonistic regimes again trying to threaten their peaceful neighbors, particularly small and weak ones. We must also reaffirm and strengthen our determination to work towards lasting peace and stability in the entire region. Mr. President, my delegation will vote in favor of the draft resolution before the Council to underscore our determination that aggression should be thwarted and not...
...points of the Boundary Commission's decision clearly stipulate that sanity has won over insanity. The rule of law has prevailed over the rule of jungle. This decision has rejected any attempt by Eritrea to get reward for its aggression. This decision was fair and legal. Badum and its surroundings, which Eritrea invaded and occupied May 1998 on the basis of its false claims, has now been decided by the Commission that Badum and its surroundings belong to Ethiopia.
Sorry, but the question is not clear. Can you clarify, if I may ask? Sorry.
How can you better explain your claim of being a candidate from the South, a development agenda candidate?
When you say that candidate, linking it with sustainable development goals?
Well, the rules to have a dialogue, but...
Can I possibly try and clarify the question? During your intervention this morning, you claimed to be a candidate coming from a developing countries. The plans you put forward in your presentation, according to His Excellency, are more related to a north part developed country type of driven agenda. So how can you claim that you are coming from a developing country and yet presenting a developed country agenda? Is that roughly what the question is? Yes?
Yesterday during the financing dialogue we heard some fears that the WHO technical cooperation might need to undergo some surgical cuts if we do not step up to commit ourselves to contribute in a more sustainable manner to the WHO budget. I would like to ask you, which technical cooperation areas do you regard being the nice to have or so-called the pet topics of the member states in which the WHO is currently active and you see the least value added in the organization action? Thank you.
Maybe if you can repeat, not clear, or if you can... Still, yes. Can you quickly repeat the question, please?
The question is...
The national level road length is increased from 37,000 2002-03 to 100,000 2011-12. Road density increased from 33.65 km per 1,000 in 2002-03 to 90.9 km per 1,000 in 2011-12. As a result, the average...
Africa is a future continent. Thank you.